Bob Hirst, general editor of the Mark Twain Project. Thanks for being with us.
Glad to be here.
When and where did Mark Twain write this piece called Concerning the Interview?
He wrote it in 1889 or 1890. We know that because of the color of the paper on which he wrote it. We don't know whether he wrote it at Hartford or Elmira, but one or the other. And he wrote it because he'd been interviewed, and he was going to be interviewed dozens and dozens of times, and he had a very strong view of what interviewing was like.
So let's read it, Concerning the Interview.
Concerning the interview, no one likes to be interviewed, and yet no one likes to say no, for interviewers are courteous and gentle-mannered, even when they come to destroy. I must not be understood to mean that they ever come consciously to destroy, or are aware afterward that they have destroyed. No, I think their attitude is more that of a cyclone, which comes with a gracious purpose of cooling off a sweltering village, and is not aware afterward that it has done that village anything but a favor. The interviewer scatters you all over creation, but he does not conceive that you can look upon that as a disadvantage. People who blame a cyclone do it because they do not reflect that compact masses are not a cyclone's idea of symmetry. People who find fault with the interviewer do it because they do not reflect that he is but a cyclone after all, though disguised in the image of God, like the rest of us. That he is not conscious of harm, even when he is dusting a continent with your remains, but only thinks he is making things pleasant for you, and that therefore the just way to judge him is by his intentions, not his works. The interview was not a happy invention. It is perhaps the poorest of all ways of getting at what is in a man. In the first place, the interviewer is the reverse of an inspiration, because you are afraid of him. You know by experience that there is no choice between these disasters. No matter which he puts in, you will see at a glance that it would have been better if he had put in the other. Not that the other would have been better than this, but merely that it wouldn't have been this. And any change must be, and would be, an improvement. Though in reality, you know very well, it wouldn't. I may not make myself clear. If that is so, then I have made myself clear. A thing which could not be done except by not making myself clear, since what I am trying to show is what you feel at such a time, not what you think. For you don't think. It is not an intellectual operation. It is only a going around in a confused circle with your head off. You only wish in a dumb way that you hadn't done it, though really you don't know which it is you wish you hadn't done. And moreover, you don't care. That is not the point. You simply wish you hadn't done it, whichever it is. Done what is a matter of minor importance and has nothing to do with the case. You get it what I mean? You have felt that way? Well, that is the way one feels over his interview in print. Yes, you are afraid of the interviewer, and that is not an inspiration. You close your shell, you put yourself on your guard, you try to be colorless, you try to be crafty, and talk all around a matter without saying anything. And when you see it in print, it makes you sick to see how well you succeeded. All the time, at every new change of question, you are alert to detect what it is the interviewer is driving at now, and circumvent him, especially if you catch him trying to trick you into saying humorous things. And in truth, that is what he is always trying to do. He shows it so plainly, works for it so openly and shamelessly, that his very first effort closes up that reservoir, and his next one caulks it tight. I do not suppose that a really humorous thing was ever said to an interviewer since the invention of his uncanny trade. Yet he must have something characteristic, so he invents the humorisms himself and interlards them when he writes up his interview. They are always extravagant, often too wordy, and generally framed in dialect, a non-existent and impossible dialect at that. This treatment has destroyed many a humorist, but that is no merit in the interviewer, because he didn't intend to do it. There are plenty of reasons why the interview is a mistake. One is that the interviewer never seems to reflect that the wise thing to do, after he is turned on this and that and the other tap by a multitude of questions, till he has found one that flows freely and with interest, would be to confine himself to that one and make the best of it and throw away the emptyings he had secured before. He doesn't think of that. He is sure to shut off that stream with a question about some other matter, and straightway his one poor little chance of getting something worth the trouble of carrying home is gone, and gone for good. It would have been better to stick to the thing his man was interested in talking about, but you would never be able to make him understand that. He doesn't know when you are delivering metal from when you are shoveling out slag. He can't tell dirt from ducats. It's all one to him. He puts in everything you say, then he sees himself that it is but green stuff and wasn't worth saying, so he tries to mend it by putting in something of his own, which he thinks is ripe, but in fact is rotten. True, he means well, but so does the cyclone. Now, his interruptions, his fashion of diverting you from topic to topic, have in a certain way a very serious effect. They leave you but partly uttered on each topic. Generally, you have got out just enough of your statement to damage you. You never get to the place where you meant to explain and justify your position.
You think that's all? Is that the ending?
No, he's interrupted himself. He hasn't finished the speech.
But that's all there is.
That's all there is.
Now, his tongue seems firmly implanted in his cheek throughout all this, don't you think?
I would say that's the normal way of his writing, yes. There's always some tongue-in-cheek, yes.
I mean, you really think he thinks of an interviewer as a cyclone who's coming around and blowing everything around?
I think he's had enough experience with that to really believe that, yes. I mean, he's been interviewed in ways that make him furious.
But wasn't Mark Twain an interviewer himself? I mean, he was a newspaper man, especially in California, in San Francisco, Virginia City. Didn't he interview people?
Well, he was a newspaper man, but interviewing of this kind, of the kind he's talking about here, is a relatively recent invention. It's invented really about the time that yellow journalism takes hold, and you have these big, enormous issues of newspapers that needed something to fill up with. So he's been interviewed frequently, really from the mid-70s on. It gets increasingly often. But I would say that as far as we know, he did not do that kind of interview in the West.
Do you think I should be insulted by this? He's pretty hard on interviewers. Cyclone and what's the word he used? Devious, destroying?
Well, there are good interviewers and bad interviewers. And I've been interviewed by people who do interrupt you so frequently that you never get to the end of your answer. And you are frequently, as he says at the very end, out there with something that that's your whole answer, really does look like you don't know what you're talking about.
So like so much of Twain, it's funny, but it's serious as well. I mean, he's got a point to make.
That's correct, he does. I mean, that's why he lives, right? If his jokes were just ephemeral, they would no longer be funny. But in fact, you can read this, it's more than 100 years old, and you're going to laugh, right? It's 120 years old.
Bob Hirst, thanks very much.
You're very welcome.